Today we're going to discuss a topic that has recently been the subject of hot debate. How many bet sizings should poker players use in their sims? I know, not the most sexy controversy in the world, but it's a debate that I personally have been dragged into by one Dominic Nietzsche. Now some of you may be wondering why I would bother arguing on the internet with someone that looks like the product of AIDS and heroin having a baby. Well, the reality is that Dom is a well-known professional poker player who apparently views life as a zero-sum game, and therefore uses his public platform to attack poker training sites that he views as threats to his app. In fact, he has bashed GTO Check unprovoked numerous times before it was even launched, and even went so far as to embarrassingly create fake accounts on YouTube and Discord in an effort to discredit us. So although it's quite clear that Dom has an agenda and isn't actually interested in any sort of good faith discussion, I've been responding to him to correct the public record that he has been distorting with his pathetic smear campaign, and this video will be my final rebuttal. So what exactly have we been arguing about? Well, apparently alongside global warming and the pandemic, Dom believes that one of the biggest threats to mankind are sims that he has deemed to include too many sizings. In fact, Dom even ordered one of his subs to devote an entire article to GTO Check that was riddled with errors and logical flaws on this very subject. To boil it all down, Dom and I fall into two separate camps when it comes to the question of the best way to simplify GTO. In Dom's camp are folks who believe that the one right way to simplify GTO is to pare down the game tree by utilizing fewer sizings and then executing the resulting simplified output as close to perfect as possible. Our view, in contrast, is that players should create robust game trees with a variety of sizings that they commonly encounter in the wild, and then simplify their execution of the output based on their own unique experience level. So who is right? Well, unlike Dom, I'm not an unaware, arrogant asshole, so I'm not going to pretend like there is only one right way to approach this problem. But there are some objective reasons why I believe the second approach is superior, which I will articulate in this video. To begin with, we need to step back and ask ourselves big picture, why anyone cares about GTO in the first place. Well, if you've watched my videos before, you would know that GTO is an unexploitable strategy with no leaks or vulnerabilities that's effective at all stakes and against all opponents. That is, when playing a GTO strategy, you are mathematically guaranteed to do no worse than break even, and if your opponent is not playing perfect GTO himself, you will win over the long run. However, this guarantee only applies in the context of the full game of poker. In other words, if we wanted to actually calculate the true unexploitable GTO strategy for no limit hold'em, we would have to create a game tree that allows each player from preflop through the river to take every legal action, fold, call, check, and bet, from min bet to all in, at each and every decision point. However, the resulting game tree would be so large and complex that the most powerful supercomputer in the world would not even be able to traverse it once, let alone solve it. And this dilemma is why some of the top AI researchers in the world have specifically chosen poker as the Mount Everest of all games to solve. And by leveraging elite programming skills and cutting-edge game theory techniques, these researchers, with very limited poker knowledge themselves, have successfully developed systems that can beat humans in both heads-up and six-max variants. So how did they accomplish this? Well, these researchers were able to crack this infinitely complex game by primarily utilizing two simplification techniques. One is called information abstraction, also known as bucketing, which most of you have heard me blather on about in several of my videos. And the second is called action abstraction. Action abstraction simply involves removing bet sizings from the full game tree until you have a small enough game that can be solved with modern tools and equipment. However, action abstraction has an inherent flaw. For every legal action you remove from the game tree, you also remove your strategies further and further away from true GTO, which means you lose any guarantee that your strategy is unexploitable or even effective. For example, you could drastically simplify a game tree by removing all donk bets, removing all raises, and only allowing each player to make a half-pot bet on each street, but the problem is that this game tree is so far removed from the full game that the resulting solution would likely deviate significantly from true GTO and be unprofitable. which raises the obvious question of what would be the point of trying to study or master such a simplified game. In other words, you cannot gain EV, but you can only lose EV by removing bet sizings from the game tree, and therefore all other things being equal, a sim that has more sizings will be closer to true GTO. So given this indisputable fact, why is Dom arguing that when it comes to bet sizings, less is more? Well, as far as I can tell, there are three main arguments that Dom has been repeating ad nauseum on this subject, and I'll address each one of these one by one. The first argument is that when you include many different sizings, the solver may start splitting its ranges significantly, which on later nodes will result in very narrow ranges. And according to Dominic, when the solver constructs strategies for very narrow ranges, the results are, in his words, nonsense. The reality is that the solver can construct optimal and balanced strategies even for ranges that have very low weight, and we can demonstrate this very clearly through an example. So on the left we have run a sim to very fine accuracy with a relatively simplified game tree for a button versus big blind cash game, 100 big blinds deep with 2 betting options on the flop and 3 betting options on the turn and river. On the right, we have run another sim, also to very fine accuracy, with all of the parameters exactly the same, except this game tree is incrementally more complex, where we added 2 additional bet sizes on the flop and 1 additional bet size on the turn and river. So here on the flop, one thing we notice right away is that in the simplified sim, the predominant bet sizing used is 75% of pot, whereas in the more complex sim, when given the option to bet full pot, the solver much prefers that sizing. But let's say in real life, a player only uses a check or bet 3/4 pot strategy in this type of spot. Could that player get any benefit from reviewing the more complex sim that only uses this sizing on the flop 1% of the time? Well, let's test this out by traversing to the river where the ranges will be the most narrow. So for each of these sims, we're going to bet 3/4 pot on the flop, have the big blind call, then the turn is the 10 of diamonds, the big blind checks, and let's say the button bets full pot, and the river is the queen of spades, and the big blind checks again. First, note that the overall ranges on a normalized basis are very close to each other in terms of the combos present. Also, putting aside the actual bet sizings used, the overall strategies are very close as well in terms of the overall level of aggression for the range, for segments, and for individual hand combos. And this is despite the fact that the button's range is only comprised of 0.26% of all possible combos in the more complex sim. So what in the world is Dom crying about? Well, when the ranges are very narrow, sometimes you'll find individual combos here and there that have extremely low probability of being in the range, like less than 1/100th of 1%, which will take an unusual action. But in those instances, you can just assume these specific combos are not part of the game tree and ignore them. Additionally, sometimes when the ranges are very narrow, EVs and frequencies may not sync up perfectly, but we're typically talking about very small differences that are not even humanly usable in real life. Overall, as we've just demonstrated, even when you're on a very narrow branch of the game tree, the solver can still do a decent job of calculating the optimal strategy. Another argument against using a variety of sizings is that it grows the game tree larger, which makes it more difficult to solve to good accuracy. And this is undeniably true, but again, we have to ask ourselves, accurate to what? As mentioned earlier, we can create a very simple game tree with only one bet size per street and solve it to an extremely low Nash distance, but this Nash distance is only measuring the exploitability of this solution, not measured against the full game of poker, but in the context of this specific overly simplified toy game. If we're talking about accuracy in the context of the sim's closeness to the true unexploitable GTO solution, well, that's an entirely different matter. So the real question should be, what is more accurate to true GTO? A more complex tree that's solved down to a good Nash distance, or a more simplified tree that is solved down to a very fine Nash distance? Well, since this criticism has been specifically directed to GTO Check, let's compare a solution produced by GTO Check to these test sims that we ran for a very long time and solved to a very fine accuracy. When we juxtapose the GTO Check sim, which is solved down to a 0.012 Nash distance, to our more complex test sim that was solved down to a 0.008 Nash distance, we see that they are virtually identical on the flop. and when we compare the GTO checksum to the sim with just two flop sizings, we see that the overall mix between checking and betting are close, but the GTO checksim, with the option to bet full pot, chooses this sizing almost exclusively because it is the higher EV play for virtually all betting combos. So although the simple sim is solved to higher accuracy, it is advising to use a lower EV strategy across the board. So given this, I'll just leave it up to the viewer to decide for himself. Between these two sims, which one would you say is more accurate to true GTO? And if we take the GTO checksim all the way down to the river with the same line, although the GTO checksim uses different sizings on the turn and river, we see that overall the strategies are still very close. So while it is true that a smaller game tree is easier to solve and will take less time, the reality is that after a certain threshold accuracy, the changes to the game tree start to become increasingly minuscule, certainly well beyond any human usability. And this is why in Michael Acevedo's book, Modern Poker Theory, which is the most comprehensive book on modern GTO and solvers, he states that he likes to run his sims to an accuracy of 0.35% of the pot on the flop. The reality is that after an accuracy of 0.5% or so of the pot, solutions for most spots will not change dramatically if they run longer. And this GTO check sim is actually solved to an accuracy of 0.2% of the pot. So despite the complexity of GTO check's game trees, we know with measurable objective certainty that the sims are solved to a low exploitability. Of course, anyone can cherry pick a few examples of hands in an obscure branch of the game tree where the EVs may not line up perfectly with the frequencies, but as we can see, 95% plus of this sim is just as, if not more accurate than the more simplified sim that solved to a lower Nash distance. The third argument against using four sizings on East Street is that a four sizing strategy is impossible to implement. There are a few things I'll say about this argument. First of all, while it is true that no human can perfectly implement a game tree that uses four sizings, it's also true that no human can perfectly implement a game tree with two or three sizings either. Right? Even the best scores on the GTO leaderboard are basically C's and D's, so the notion that four sizings is way too complex, but two or three sizings is just right, is pure gaslighting and propaganda of a level that Dom's ancestors surely would be proud of. Secondly, just because there are 4-bet sizings in a sim, it doesn't mean that players actually need to implement 4-bet sizings in real life. Again, the philosophy of GTO Check is to solve a robust game tree and then simplify the resulting output in our execution. I personally only use 1-2 sizings in most spots, but in developing GTO Check, we had to create a flexible game tree structure that would work across all spots. MTTs, heads up, cash, deep stacked, short stacked, spins, and in checkdown lines or triple barrel lines. So it made logical sense to use a default game tree that, in each node, spans the types of bet sizes that players will most often encounter across all games. A small bet, a medium bet, a large bet, and a very large bet. And of course, you won't know whether the solver will prefer a sizing unless you include it in the game tree. And as we saw from this example, the actual implementation of the more complex sim doesn't actually need to be more complicated. In this scenario, you could use the same big bet or check strategy on the flop, but your larger sizing is just going to win you more EV in the long run. And finally, going back to what we discussed earlier, when you remove bet sizings from the game tree, you remove any guarantees of unexploitability, which raises the question of whether perfect implementation of an imperfect sim is something that we should even be striving for. For example, in the simplified sim, Ace of Diamonds, Queen of Hearts is checking 100% of the time on the river. However, in the more complex sim, Ace of Diamonds, Queen of Hearts is betting 3/4 pot 100% of the time. This is despite the fact that all of the parameters of both games are exactly the same. The exact same stack sizes, exact same board, and exact same line taken. The only difference is that the complex game tree has 1-2 additional bet sizings which were not even used in this specific line. So what is causing this divergence in strategies? Well, optimal strategies are wholly dependent on range matchups. That is, when a player has a decision, his profit-maximizing strategy for value betting or calling or bluffing or trapping hinges on the probabilities that his opponent has or does not have certain combos in his range. And this is true for both the solver and in real life. Right, to use a very simple example, if your opponent raises preflop and you call in the big blind and the board is king, king, jack, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to know that the probability of your opponent having a very strong hand is high on this board because the likely hands in his range smashed this flop, which means you should be more inclined to fold compared to if, for example, the board was 4, 5, 6 instead. And so unless all of your opponents are playing the exact same game tree as you are, which of course they won't be doing, what happens when you artificially limit the size of the game tree by removing legal bets is each player's perception of the player's ranges will become mismatched. To understand the importance of this, let's look at an example. So instead of using the same line as before, where the button's range became very narrow, let's assume the action went check check on the flop, and the turn is the ace of diamonds and the big blind checks again. Now let's say that player A is holding queen 10 of hearts, and player A uses the more simplified game tree that provides for three betting options in this spot, 30%, 80%, and 175%. According to this sim, checking or betting 30% or 80% are close in EV, and the highest frequency play is to check, and so player A decides to check. But let's say that player A's opponent, player B, uses the more complex game tree, which provides for the exact same turn sizings as the simplified game, but adds one additional size, a 55% pot bet. Well, according to player B sim, player A should be mostly using the 55% pot bet with queen 10 of hearts, and he should not be checking at all, as it is the lowest EV play. What this means is that when player A decides to check here, because in his mind that is the best play according to his sim, from player B's perspective, player A's river range should no longer contain queen 10 of hearts because that was the worst play according to player B's sim. And this type of misalignment will occur with different combos throughout the range, which ultimately causes a divergence in the optimal strategies produced from each player's respective game trees, particularly for hands that are indifferent or near indifferent, because the strategies for these types of borderline hands are usually very sensitive to range matchups due to the impact of card removal, which is entirely dependent on the specific frequencies of combos within each player's range. The upshot of all this is that when you create a very simple game tree and solve it with the goal of implementing it perfectly, if your opponents are using a different game tree, which of course they are, the lines that you thought were EV maximizing could actually be blunders when transposed to the full game. So does this mean that a simplified game tree is useless? Well, given that GTO Checks game trees are also simplified, I would have to say no. Although there aren't any GTO trading tools that can currently provide any guarantee of effectiveness, most of these tools can still be very useful if they're utilized in a thoughtful way, and I have a few recommendations in this regard. The first recommendation is that since there are no guarantees that our sims are actually accurate to true GTO, players should not get too hung up on trying to memorize the exact frequencies produced by the sims. Instead, players should primarily focus on EV, which is generally more resilient to slight changes in ranges, and in particular, they should concentrate on spots where they are making the largest EV errors. Although it's impossible to know whether a particular bet sizing in our simplified tree is the actual optimal sizing in true GTO, we can have a relatively high degree of confidence that large EV mistakes in simple trees will still be large EV mistakes within the full game. To explain, let's use a very simple example. Let's say that we're facing a decision and we have two choices, option A and option B. Option A will yield us 10 big blinds on average, and option B will yield us 2 big blinds on average. If we decided to choose option B over option A in this spot, it would be a relatively large 8 big blind error. But what happens when we make this game tree more complex by adding other options? Well, although it may turn out that option A wasn't actually the best choice, we can have at least some confidence that option B will continue to not be the best choice, and will likely still be a large mistake, no matter how many additional options we add, because we can be pretty certain that, at a minimum, it will always at least be inferior to option A. In other words, given the degree of EV disparity, option B is likely a dominated action that will always have at least one better alternative, meaning that we can remove it from the game tree entirely without any EV loss. And this is one of the reasons why GTO Check prioritizes EV over frequencies, and why we place a heavy emphasis on EV regret, which measures the maximum EV loss for simplifications. We can't be certain that all the frequencies in our sims are absolutely correct, but we can be quite certain that we should be avoiding lines that result in large EV losses. The second recommendation is that when you're setting up your game tree, you should generally try to provide ample coverage for the types of bet sizings you commonly encounter in your games. And there are two primary reasons for this. The first is that if you limit the sizings in your tree very narrowly, you could be missing out on EV because, as mentioned, you simply will not know what sizing the solver prefers the most unless you include them within your tree. Now, a common counterargument to this point is that you can simplify a game tree significantly and not lose much in aggregate EV, and also the EVs of relatively close betting options will often run close together, particularly on the flop. However, the reality is that no one is truly capturing all of the EV from any sim, even a less complex one, and it's quite obvious that in certain circumstances you can potentially leave chips on the table if you rigidly adhere to a simplified limited game tree. For example, let's assume that we're on the button with Ace Queen of Diamonds. In the simplified sim, the solver is betting this hand 75%, essentially 100% of the time, and in the complex sim, the solver is betting this hand full pot, essentially 100% of the time. However, we see that the EV differences between betting full pot and the other options are relatively small. This means that on average, across all possible runouts and all possible strategies and counter strategies of our opponent, we can expect to win roughly the same amount regardless of the option we choose. So does this mean that our additional betting options are meaningless? Well, not quite. If we traverse to the river with the exact same board and with the exact same line in both sims, with the only difference being that we chose the preferred full pot bet on the flop in the more complex sim, we see that the EV for this exact same combo on the river is around 9 big blinds higher in the more complex sim compared to the simple sim. The second reason why using a reasonably robust game tree can be beneficial is that although we cannot guarantee that our sims are analogous to true GTO, if our toy game includes bet sizes that are in the vicinity of the most commonly used actions we typically see in our player pools, we can have more confidence that our sims will be relatively effective. This is because even though our game trees will never encapsulate all of the potential bet sizes we'll see in the wild, the closer a bet size in our tree is to one that is actually used in the real game, the closer the EVs will be between such sizings. One of the techniques game theory researchers have historically used to deal with bet sizes that are outside of their abstracted game trees is called action translation. That is, when an agent encounters a bet size that's not within the agent's abstracted game tree, it will map the novel sizing to the closest one within the abstracted game tree and then formulate an adjusted response. And so when you have a game tree that provides ample coverage for the types of bet sizes you encounter in real life, this action translation mapping process will, all other things being equal, be more accurate. So for example, let's say we're in the big blind and the button bets 150% pot, which we see is the sizing that the solver actually prefers the most in this spot. Well, if we have only studied a tree that allows for a 75% pot bet at most, we may have a hard time adjusting to the larger sizing because it is so far removed from our game tree. This is especially true because optimal defense is something that is difficult to reason to based on an understanding of principles. Generally, optimal defense is most efficiently learned through pure repetition, studying many different responses to various sizings and building an intuitive understanding of how the cutoff point between folding and defending changes depending on the size. So if you have a more robust tree, which also includes a 100% pot bet, for example, your adjustment to an overbet will, all other things being equal, be more precise. And the third and final recommendation when it comes to making the most out of solver study is to focus on why the solver is doing what it's doing. Now, to some, this may seem like a nonsensical endeavor because at the end of the day, all a solver is an EV maximizing calculator. It doesn't know what a bluff is, or how to trap, or what balance is. It just identifies lines that make the most number of chips on average, that's it. However, to use an analogy, even though a hummingbird doesn't consciously learn or know how it flies, scientists have still been able to unlock secrets of aerodynamics with real-world applicability by studying their flight. Similarly, although the solver doesn't actually have any formal strategy or consciously know what it's doing, we can study its outputs to learn how to optimally maximize EV. Yes, it is true that all sims, even very complex ones, are really just toy games designed to replicate the full game of poker. However, toy games can still be useful to illuminate the principles and mechanics of EV maximization, which is why in every poker game theory book ever written, the author always includes very simplified toy games to illustrate these principles and mechanics. In other words, when we input assumptions A and B into the solver, and the solver spits out solutions Y and Z, trying to rotely memorize Y and Z probably isn't going to be very useful when we know that our assumptions are flawed and therefore we don't have any guarantees that our solutions are accurate. However, it can be incredibly useful to understand how the solver got from A and B to Y and Z, because once we master that, we will be much better equipped to reason our way to finding EV maximizing responses when the assumptions change from A and B to C and D, or E and F, and so on and so forth. And this is why the core mission of GTO Check and each of my videos is to understand how the solver maximizes EV from the assumed inputs. I'm fully aware of the fact that learning how to specifically play a 4-bet pot against Phil Ivey holding ace 10 off on an ace king deuce 2-tone board in a heads up sit and go is probably not going to be very useful, since none of us will ever encounter that exact same scenario in the future. But that's not the point. The point is to understand the general principles of EV maximization, such as the importance of card removal when bluff catching, because these principles can be applied across many scenarios. In other words, a deeper understanding of the principles of EV maximization, as opposed to a rote and rigid memorization of narrowly defined game trees, will ultimately give your game more fluidity and flexibility across different games and spots. Bitch, be humble. Holla, bitch. Sit down. Holla, holla, be humble. Bitch. Holla, bitch. Sit down. Be humble. Bitch, sit down. Be humble. Sit down. Be humble. Sit down. Be humble. Sit down. Bitch, sit down. Be humble. Sit down.